It's a pattern that shouldn't be familiar, yet already is. Hamas and Islamic Jihad rockets streaking across the sky from Gaza. Sirens ringing out, warning Israelis to take cover. The Iron Dome intercepting as many incoming projectiles as possible. The punishing retaliation of an air assault on Gaza targets by Israeli forces, pushing the casualty count higher with each cycle. Dimming the hopes for de-escalation of violence and exposing the harsh reality of a long-standing conflict boiling over into rage once again. What started as a flashpoint over threatened evictions of Palestinian families from the Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood of East Jerusalem and clashes at the Al-Aqsa Mosque is now a conflict that the UN Special Envoy to the Middle East says is escalating towards an all-out war. Israel calling up reservists and moving tanks and heavy artillery to the Gaza border, refusing to rule out a ground offensive. Defense Minister Benny Gantz making clear Israel has no intention of backing down.
In hundreds of strikes, weapons, production sites, tunnels, and towers that have been serving terror organizations have crumbled, and they will keep crumbling. There are many more targets. This is just the beginning.
Hamas confirming some leaders of their armed wing killed in the latest round of airstrikes while vowing that nothing will stop their battle. A Hamas spokesman calling for Palestinians to march in Jerusalem to the Al-Aqsa Mosque on Friday, saying your alarm towards Al-Aqsa is a pledge of loyalty to the blood of the righteous martyrs in Gaza with honor and an affirmation of continuing the path of liberation. Anger now spilling beyond Jerusalem into other cities. The city of Lod becoming the latest powder keg. A state of emergency and curfew now in effect after an Arab-Israeli man was shot dead and rioters torched synagogues, cars, and businesses there. In the meantime, civilians continue to pay the heaviest price as Gaza citizens try to salvage what's left of bombed-out buildings, all while mourning and burying their dead. With scores killed and several hundred injured, while in Israel, with every siren, a warning that another missile might make it through, as several have already claimed lives. Hadas Gold, CNN, Jerusalem.
Well, Neri Zilber is a journalist joining us from Tel Aviv, and thank you. What's the latest where you are there, Neri?
Well, here in northern Tel Aviv, it's rather quiet after a barrage of rockets earlier this afternoon. Quiet but tense. Most Israelis, even in Tel Aviv, which is relatively far away from Gaza and relatively far away from the intercommunal riots in other mixed cities, it's tense. People are home, staying home Thursday afternoon. Here in Tel Aviv, it's the start of the weekend, very little traffic on the road, and expecting additional barrages later on this evening from the Gaza Strip.
This action from Hamas indicates that it is pretty much upping its ante, doesn't it? Not only using rockets, but drones as well. This from a group enclosed in a blockaded strip of land that's, what, 5 miles by 25. Why and how did Hamas get this powerful? And when did it build up such an arsenal?
Well, it's probably important to realize that Hamas rules over the Gaza Strip like a state. It has its own government, it has its own military, it's blockaded by Israel and Egypt, but it's in recent years been left alone in this rather arrangement that it's come to with Israel, where Israel gets quiet and Hamas gets funding, infrastructure repairs, and it's had time in recent years to build up this arsenal. And like any good government, it improves the arsenal, it launches missile tests, and so what the result we're seeing now in recent days is exactly that, a greater Hamas capability to reach farther into Israel and launch barrages against Tel Aviv particular that has never been seen before.
Neri, an article in the FT today claiming that, and I quote them here, for now hostilities do appear to have achieved their political ends for both Hamas and Netanyahu. This is a pretty cynical view, but let me just lay it out. Hamas displaying its ability to strike deep into Israeli territory, and Netanyahu was on the cusp of losing his premiership, reasserting himself as Mr. Security. Of course, his plans to build a coalition to oust him, which required an Islamist party to back, another prime minister have been shelved at this point. As I say, this is a cynical view, a sense that there has been some opportunism here. But do you believe that view has merit?
That's a rather cynical view of the politics, but I do agree that the politics right now, especially in the middle of this escalation, are playing the critical role. Hamas looks at Israel right now with riots on the streets, Arabs and Jews at each other's throats, and is looking to up the ante and perhaps tip the scales over into all-out uprising by Palestinians both in Israel, in Jerusalem, and the West Bank. That's on the Hamas side. On the Israeli side, as you mentioned, the politics are quite complicated in terms of post-election politics. Netanyahu would like the opposition to not be able to form this government, but in the meantime, he's losing the country with rioting in the streets and Israelis hunkering down in bomb shelters. So it's a very fine line for Netanyahu to play. And at the moment, it looks like he's rather losing control of this country.
What do you make of this, quote, mob violence on the streets of some of these Israeli cities? I mean, Benjamin Netanyahu has described this as anarchy.
Well, it does very much look like anarchy, particularly because the Israeli police appears helpless to stop it. And we should remember it's Arab violence visited upon Jews, as well as Jewish violence visited upon Arabs inside Israel. Unprecedented in both the scale of it, in terms of the various locations all across Israel that this is happening in, and the real nastiness that we're seeing out on the streets. And the Israeli police, as well as other security forces, are preparing for an even worse night tonight. And so that's just an indication of the fact that, at least on part of the Israeli authorities, it looks like they're rather losing control of the situation.
Let's just remind ourselves that this all started because of a long-standing and incredibly sensitive legal battle over Palestinian homes in East Jerusalem. I'm talking about this all started, you know, the most recent uptick in violence that we've seen. Israel's High Court has delayed that hearing on what Palestinians would call forced eviction. But that hearing is still coming. So whether or not we see a de-escalation now between Palestinians and Israelis, whether that's between Netanyahu and Hamas or whether that's on the streets of these Israeli cities, should we expect to see this happen all over again in 30 days or so?
Well, I think the fact that the Supreme Court postponed that decision very late in the day, precisely because of the fears that it would escalate the situation on the ground, perhaps gives us hope that it will do so in 30 days and not allow that particular and rather controversial court decision to really undermine overall stability in Israel and the Palestinian territories. But the point is well taken, that even if the current hostilities are contained and things de-escalate on the ground, whether inside Israel or Gaza, the issue of Jerusalem, whether that particular Jerusalem neighborhood or the Al-Aqsa Mosque, if that is seen to be violated again, that itself could spark violence and unrest once again. So it really is the core of the conflict, Jerusalem is, and it needs to be handled very carefully, which is a lesson I think the Netanyahu government right now is learning.